It is good to see you. I know that we're here to worship and to fellowship and to pray and to take communion and just listen to a message. And also there's food that we're having after the service today. So excited to see you. Glad that you're here. Hopefully, when you walked in, you grabbed one of the bulletins. We have a few announcements on the back that I want to make sure that you are aware of. One, obviously, is that we're having a potluck immediately after the service this morning. So at the closing prayer, when we're done this morning, not only will I be dismissing us, but I'll be praying for the food. So you can go back there and enjoy. And it smells amazing. I don't know if you walked in, you smelled food. And we're going to have a good time with this. So I'm glad that we're going to be able to do that. Also, tonight, Bible study at 6 o'clock. We have youth at 6 o'clock as well. Tonight, for the Bible study, we're going to be starting in 1 Thessalonians. And so we'll continue with that, and then we're going to do a study for a little while on what it means to be the church. Also, next Sunday is the Brotherhood Breakfast. It'll be here at 7:30. So, guys, you like breakfast? Come hang out. Eat some breakfast. You want to hear maybe a message or inspiration from some people that are coming? Come and hang out for a little while. I know it tends to be long being here at 7:30 for us to eat, but think about the people who cook the food. They got here at like 6, so they're going to be here even longer. But if you want to be a part of the Brotherhood Breakfast, please let us know. Also, we are still looking for people to make communion, get it prepped for Sunday mornings. We've got several months of people who have already had that filled, but we are still looking for more people who want to serve in that capacity. So sign-up sheet is down in the foyer. All right, that is all of the announcements that I have. So would you please do me a favor? Let's stand as we have our opening prayer. Father God, we come before you and we humble ourselves before you. Yeah, I know that takes a lot sometimes for us to say. Father, I know that in life, as we become a Christian and we learn and we grow, that we have to humble ourselves before you and say, you are in charge. And so, Father, when we come together on Sunday mornings, we come together and it's not just a room filled with men and women, but it's filled with brothers and sisters in Christ. We're supposed to have that unity and that love and that compassion for one another as we live in this world. And so, Father, we are so excited to do that. But, Father, I also know that when we come before you like this, that we come and we do take communion, we recognize what Jesus did on the cross for us. And we can't thank you enough, Jesus, for dying for us. And then when we sing these songs, Father, I pray that they are a fragrant offering to you, that we sing with all of our heart, we sing with all of our might, and that we just want to serve you. And when we listen to the message and we figure out what it is that you are trying to tell us and how we need to live a life that impacts people around us, Father, that's amazing in itself. But Father, what we are really asking, what we are really begging, is that you change our life. Change it to be more like Jesus. Build us the way that we're supposed to be so that we can glorify you and honor you every single day, no matter where, no matter what, so that we can put you first. Thank you, Father, for all that you do for us. Thank you for sending your son, Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none. upon. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation.
Yesterday, got to spend some time with some good Christian friends of mine and listen to a good preacher friend of mine from Columbus speak about communion. And when he talked about it, he really got a hold of me. And so I'm going to kind of mimic my best of my ability to what he said and try to convey the same message to you guys. So, at the supper that night, when Jesus broke the bread and he told them, "This is my body broken for you," they really didn't have an understanding of what he was trying to tell them. They did not know. They were in denial about what he had been telling them, that he was fixing to give his life for them, for us. And so when he did that night, think about what they were thinking and how much value they put on that piece of bread. And then he told them, "This cup is a new covenant. This is my blood that I'm shedding for you." And they drank of it like we do all the time. But I wonder what kind of value they put in it that night. I bet the value that they put in it that night wasn't the same as the next time they did it. Because the next time they did it was after they had seen our Savior give his life for us, for them. And that's a big thing, is the value we put on it. So if we're taking that little bit of juice and that little cracker, and it's just something we ritualistically do on a Sunday morning because we have the opportunity to do it here every Sunday. If that's just a cracker and a piece of bread, you're better off leaving it back there. Because if you do it without the right mindset and the right heart set, you're wasting your time and his effort. I've lost a loved one very dear to me. And I know many of you probably have too. What do I value the life that I lost? A lot. His life, Jesus' life, is worth more than all of our lives. So where do we put that value? He had the opportunity when he was on that cross to call down tens of thousands of angels to wipe us out. We would have never had this opportunity if he hadn't have been obedient to the Father. And the Father loved us enough that he gave his Son for us. So the disciples, they continued this after his death, or we wouldn't know anything about it. We wouldn't be doing it if they hadn't continued it. But I guarantee you that their value on that cup and on that bread after they saw our Savior die was a whole lot greater. And that's where we should value it as well. So take a minute. Get your mind right. Get your heart right. And truly think about the value of what we're remembering and what it should mean to us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, that you did give your life for us. Thank you, Jesus, that you were obedient to the Father, and God, that you gave your Son for us. Lord, that there is a tremendous value there that, Lord, we all take for granted at some point in time or another. But, Lord, I pray that you will touch us and help us to think about what kind of value we should. You know, I don't think our minds can even have a value great enough of the worth of your Son's body and his blood, Jesus, that you willingly gave for us. Father, please forgive us when we do take it for granted, and help us to do better. Lord, help us to do things every day in our actions, our words, to glorify you. And Lord, let us get ourselves out of the way and let you be what you want us to be. Thank you, Jesus, for this church. Thank you for all that you've done for us. In Jesus' name.
in order for us to live the life that he wants us to live, in order for us to pursue the dreams and the desires that he wants for us, and to build that those stepping stones of serving him and honoring him and glorify him, it takes the first moment of you bowing down before him and saying, I'm going to live my life for you, and you are my king. Therefore, we bow down before him.
You and praise your name.
We can't thank you enough for the relationship that we get to have with Jesus as being holy. We fall down before him. We call him holy. We call you holy, Father, because we recognize that you are the King. We recognize that you are the Savior. We recognize that all things come from you and through you. And because of that, Father, we have that relationship with you where we recognize you as being the one who paves everything before us and allows us to go through the hard times and the good times. But Father, we also know because of all of those things that you are allowing us to endure, you are the way maker. Thank you, Father, for being that for our lives. Show us how we can glorify your name.
Working in this place, I worship you, I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle work.
Is who he is. Those are the things that he does for us. When does he ever abandon you? Never. Is he always standing by your side? Yeah. Does he always love you? Yeah. Always.
Always. My foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way.
Morning. What a wonderful day it is. The last 2 days I was battling really hard with a cold. And I was praying for the Lord to ease that cold. And it seems like the more I got excited about the worship, the more the cold came on me. And I was available, made myself available for the enemy to infiltrate, to keep me down. until I realized he got no dominion over me. If I want to worship our Lord, I worship our Lord. If I have a cold, I have a cold, and I still worship him and I sing for him because I know I got fellow worshipers here. They can lift up a joyful noise and lift up his holy name. That's why I didn't bow down, because we give up too many times. But then it came to my mind, perseverance is not a word, it's an action. We have to stay in it. Even when hardship falls on us, we have to pull through. I'm not here to entertain you guys, I'm here to worship him. And I hope you worship with me together. Okay, he needs to have it tuned. We need... Eric, can we have your guitar? His string popped. We got a string malfunction. Yes. See, that is the enemy. The enemy tried to keep us from worshiping. The enemy is really not happy what happens here. You see the rise of Christians again. You see the belief getting stronger. The enemy don't like that. And I'm happy that I see that he doesn't like it. That means we are on the right track, we do something right. But I'm not worried about it. We can do it a cappella too if you want to. You didn't get a fresh battery. Be good. Praise the Lord. Open the eyes to my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. High and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory.
place of my heart, I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you, to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love, let's be dry, holy.
Never forget, worship is a service to our Lord. It's an honor. Don't take it for granted. It's not to entertain you. It's to lift up His glory, to make Him feel that we in need of His presence. Because, I mean, we set Him so many times aside. Worship is a way to give Him praise and glory. We're not here to entertain each other. And I feel it in my heart. We need to step up and really glorify His holy name. He's for us there every day. Let's step it up. Each time you think about Him, tell Him how holy He is. Thank you so much.
Is it 2 weeks in a row that I'm having short sermons? That's what I thought. All right, so let's just jump in. How about that? So turn in your Bibles to Acts. We're going to be looking at chapter 17. I'm going to be going through chapter 17. And when you get towards the middle of Acts, this chapter here, it's really where I want to kind of kick off, but I need to do it from the very beginning. So go ahead and just start in verse 1, and I'm going to start reading through. And here it is that Paul, he is on his missionary journey. So he's going around from city to city and preaching and teaching and sharing and glorifying. Now, here's the thing about when you get in the middle, when he goes to Athens, really what the focus of my sermon is going to be all about, because here it is. He is literally teaching us how is it that we are going to be able to reach our community. And I think that's very important for all of us to be able to understand. There's two groups that he shows here. All right, so we're going to look at the first group, then we're going to look at the second group, but we got to start in chapter 17, starting in verse 1, and then we'll work our way all the way through. So it says this, verse 1. So when Paul and his companions had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, and they're on the way to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue, as was his custom, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days, he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving that the Messiah had to suffer and to rise from the dead. This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Messiah, he said. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and quite a few prominent women. But other Jews were jealous. So they rounded up some of the bad characters from the marketplace and formed a mob and started a riot in the city. They rushed to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out into the crowd. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some other believers before the city officials, shouting, "These men who have been caused trouble all over the world have now come here and Jason has welcomed them into his house. They are all defying Caesar's decree, saying that there is another king, one called Jesus." When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. They made Jason and the other post bond and let them go. Who were they looking for? Paul and Silas. Who did they find? Jason and his household, right? Sometimes there's collateral damage. If you are going and you're doing the things that God wants you to do, if you're going out proclaiming and teaching and showing, and sometimes there's going to be collateral damage. They were going for the wrong people, but they said, yeah, they're going to do. Jason will do. Yeah, we don't have the people that we want, but these guys will do. We'll take them out and we'll proclaim these guys are causing turmoil. Where are they? They're just staying at his house. Let's get the preacher over at First Christian Church. Oh, he's not there right now. Well, you'll do. You go there, right? You'll do. And then he goes on. In Berea. As soon as it was night, the believers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Berean Jews were of more noble character than those in Thessalonica, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul was said was true. Yeah. Oh, this is awesome. We're hearing all these things about who Jesus is, about what he had to go through and what he had to do, and they were eager to hear it. But they said, we're going to have to test what you're saying first. Even though we like what you're saying, even though we hear what you're saying, even though we agree with what you're saying, we don't trust you yet. So verify what the scripture has to say. Don't trust me either. Verify. Read your scriptures. Read what the Bible has to say. Verify. And he goes on. As a result, many of them believed, and so did a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. But when the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God in Berea, some of them went up there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. The believers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed in Berea. They escorted Paul. Those who escorted Paul brought him to Athens, and then it was instructed for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. So, Paul, hey, we love that you're here, but you got to go. We'll catch up with you later. All right? Now, One of the things that, if you've been studying with me in Sunday school, and we've been going through the book of Acts, where did Paul always go first when he went into a new city? To the synagogues. Why would you go to the synagogues? Because their people are receptive to the scriptures. You go to the people who are going to be receptive to hear the word of God. He didn't go to other places. He went there. He went there and he was teaching them first, teaching them first, teaching them first. And if there wasn't one there, he went down to the creeks where the Jews would go and meet, and then they would pray. And so he was able to talk with them there and share with them there. So you go to the people who are receptive. Now we're in the book of Athens. Now we're not in the book of Athens. Now we're going to Athens. All right? Sorry, not the book of Athens. Turn in your Bibles to the book of Athens. No, you won't find it. But let's look at this. All right? Then we're going to go on. It says this. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see all the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with both Jews and God-fearing Greeks, as well as those in the marketplace, day by day with those who happened to be there. Now, I understand all about that, about being in a place that was so full of idols. Because the first time that I flew into India and I got off the plane and was walking down the ramp to go into the terminal, as soon as you got on that ramp and you started walking down, right in front of you on the wall before you turned right to get in the terminal was Shiva, an idol sitting right there. And I went, and I said to him, "There's an idol." He goes, "Better get used to it." And you walked out of that terminal, or you walked out of that ramp and you went into the terminal and you saw idols sitting all over the place, idols everywhere, and people standing before the idols, worshiping and worshiping and worshiping and praying to those idols. They were everywhere. And I said to him, as we were driving, we had 23 hours to get there with layovers, and then we had a 10-hour van ride. And as we were riding and driving along the roads, everywhere we'd look, every 100 yards, 75 yards, there was another idol and people worshiping. Went into the store on Friday in Starkville, and a man there, India, and I looked at him and said, "Oh, where did you puja?" He looked at me, he goes, "Puja?" I said, "Yeah, you puja'd." He goes, "Well, there is no place here for me. The closest India temple is in Jackson here, but there's also one over in Birmingham. But no, I did this on my own. I have a idol in my house, a god." Oh, puja. Better get used to it. Because those idols that he saw were everywhere. And the idols that we have here in the United States are right in plain sight. But he went to the synagogue, and there Jews and God-fearing Greeks. And then in verse 18 it says, a group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to debate with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" They said that this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Called him a babbler. When you hear of a babbler, or when you listen to a babbler, what do? They're just talking on and on and on about nonsense. This is what they thought of Paul when he was there. Here's this guy coming and teaching us about who Jesus is and the resurrection of the dead. He's a babbler. He doesn't know what he's talking about. He's ignorant. He doesn't have a clue of what really is going on. Don't listen to him, not necessarily really listen to him, but you know what? Because he doesn't know what he's talking about. And yet what Paul is doing, he's going to the place where the people are at least kind of receptive to hearing the message about Jesus, even though they refused to listen to him at that moment and they called him names. He stood there and preached the gospel without wavering on the message. too many times in our culture, we waver on the message in order to attract people so that they possibly could hear the gospel. He's teaching us right here what we need to do in front of those who are receptive. Now we're going to learn about how he can talk to those who possibly could be receptive. But you got to look at his technique first. Then he goes on, he says this. Then they took him and brought him to at a meeting in the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we would like to know what you mean." Ah, receptive! Hey, you're a babbler, and I know that you're just saying all these things, and you may not know exactly what you're talking about, but, hey, we kind of want to hear more about this. All right. Look at verse 21. Here's the reason why. "And all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas." They're going to want to know about this. So I'm going to go to there. And now we're going to here to share the gospel. Because they want to know even a little bit about it. They want to know the gospel just a little bit. So how does he hook them? He's got them hooked a little bit, right? He's cast that line out there. He's waiting for them to bite, waiting for the bobber to go up and down. They're waiting for the little, I don't know how to fish. Anyway, so then he goes on, he says this. Verse 22, "When Paul stood up at the meeting of the Areopagus and said, 'People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship. I even found an altar to the inscription to an unknown God.'" Guys, I appreciate you letting me be here. I'm glad that I'm going to be able to talk to you and share with you about this message that I've been preaching and teaching all over town. And I'm glad that you brought me here. But here's the thing that I noticed about you guys. You guys want to know. I see you're religious people. I see that you're wanting to talk about these things. I know that you want to hear about these things. I know that you have all this. And believe it or not, on my way over here, I saw that inscription about an unknown God. Let me tell you about that unknown God. They wanted to hear. They were receptive. There's a lot of times where you're going to be places and going places where they don't want to know the gospel. But you wait for your opportunity. Went into another store on Friday. I walk in and they know who I am. Lady behind the counter goes, "I was just mentioning, I need to go to a church, and you just happened to walk in. Where do you preach at?" First Christian Church. "Where is that?" And like Chris said, and I heard him say this on Friday, "It's across the street from the really big churches." But, hey, let me send you our app. You can read all about us, watch some videos, see who we are. What's your phone number? I'm just going to send it to you. I won't bother you after that, but here, maybe I'll come and see you on a Sunday. Yeah, I hope so. We would love to have you. How's your approach to tell people about Jesus? What do? See, you're religious. Here's an idol to this unknown God. Let me explain to you about this unknown God. Opening the door for you to be able to share the gospel with people. That's what Paul's trying to teach you. There's opportunities. There's doors that are opening all over the place. And I know that the food is going to be ready. So here we go. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of the heaven and the earth, who does not live in temples built by human hands. So, hey, the God who did all this is not found in that idol that I'm going to tell you about, but he made everything around us. And then he goes on and he says this, and then it's verse 25, and he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. For one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appropriate times and history and boundaries for the lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. And some of our own poets have said, we are his offerings. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone or images made by human design or skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance. But now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world in justice, just as the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to this everyone by raising him from the dead. And when they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, we want to hear you again on this subject. At that, Paul left that council. Some of the people became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, and also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. Let me tell you about this God. Let me tell you about this Jesus. And how long was the testimony? Let me share with you, it's this big. And some believed, some didn't, and others said, hey, we want to hear more about this. Yeah, let's meet again. We have to find people who are receptive. We have to have the relationship or find a way to talk to the people so that they can see a way in. It's not about just going, bam, here it is. Hey, can you tell me more about this? Yeah, I can. Let's talk. All right, let's go ahead and close with our opening prayer. Closing prayer. How about that? Sorry about that. Father God, thank you so much. I praise you and thank you for the time of worship that we all had together. I mean, we sang songs and we prayed and we took communion to remember what Jesus did on the cross for us. And now we listen to a message about our relationship with you and how we can share that with others, because Father, that is what you are asking us to do. You are asking us to devote our lives to making disciples, being that light to people who want to know, and we get to share and we get to help them transform their lives from being, as Paul said, ignorant in a way from God to being found in him and wanting to worship and to glorify him. And so Father, we are so grateful for that. Father, change us. Mold us. Show us. Let Jesus just live in us so that we can impact the world for you. And so, Father, I'm asking that you please open up our ears and our eyes so that we can spiritually hear and see the things that we needed to today. And thank you so much for just guiding us every single moment. Father, I know that when we leave here, we're going to be going over into the other part of the building and having a meal together. It's a meal with family. It's a meal with friends. It's a meal that we can have together to glorify you as well. So thank you, Father, for everything. May you bless the food to strengthen and nourish us and help us, Father, to keep seeking after you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.